On a clear July day in 1883, a trim black and white steamship named the Idaho glided through the still waters of the Alaskan Panhandle. Floating past on all sides were mountainous islands and thickly wooded shores. For 16 years, the United States had owned the territory after purchasing it from Russia. To most Americans, however, Alaska still loomed as strange and unknown as the continent of Africa. The isolated frontier towns and wilderness settlements counted on the mail steamers for outside communication. Every month, the Idaho or another ship like it left port in the Pacific Northwest and traveled up the 1,000-mile-long Inside Passage, delivering mail and supplies. Sometimes a few tourists went along for the ride. This time, the captain veered off the known course. The move would bring fame to him and to the Idaho and to one of the passengers on board, a 26-year-old newspaper woman named Eliza Ruhama Sidmore. The Irish-born captain, James Carroll, was one of the most experienced navigators in the Pacific Northwest. For years, he had been curious about the great, mysterious bay, whose grandeur was the stuff of local legend. Indians who hunted sea otters nearby told of icy walls extending in all directions. The roar of giant ice sheets breaking away was so thunderous, one local trader said, that it rattled the teacups in his cabin. For two summers, a wild-looking geologist named John Muir had come to Alaska to study glaciers. He spent several weeks paddling about the bay with several Indian guides and a young preacher from Fort Wrangell. Captain Lester Beardsley of the U.S. Navy had named it Glacier Bay in 1880. But his efforts to explore failed when heavy fog and fast-moving icebergs, some as big as houses, made the waters too treacherous. Now, most of the area was still uncharted territory. Captain Carroll decided to steer the Idaho into the bay and go and take a look. No ship had ever gone before into the upper reaches of Glacier Bay. Eliza, too, was curious. She had crossed the continent by train from Washington, D.C. to see the Alaska wilderness and to write about it for newspaper readers. Accounts of that journey and a return trip she made the following summer became the first complete travelogue on Alaska. By the 1890s, Americans would flock in droves to cruises along the Inside Passage, with stops in Glacier Bay. Eliza found Alaska enchanting. When the sun rose at 3 a.m., she and the other passengers gathered on deck to watch the panorama of dawn against the mountain walls. The clear, soft stillness of the sky, she said, made it seem like the dawn of creation in some new paradise. As the Idaho sailed through the mouth of Glacier Bay, the captain and pilot pointed to a green and mountainous island and decided to name it for Eliza. The words Sidmore Island were recorded on the ship's log. Then, the ship rounded Willoughby Island. 5 miles up ahead, at the end of a narrow inlet, the passengers and crew got their first view of a truly spectacular sight. The massive Muir Glacier, named for John Muir himself. Formed by more than a dozen tributary glaciers coming together, it stretched several miles wide and 40 feet high across the front. The Idaho anchored an eighth of a mile away. Bathed in shadows, the bay had a dark, eerie calm, punctuated by deep moans and sharp cracks like rifle shots. The vast, desolate wall of ice that faced us had a strange fascination, Eliza wrote, and the crack of the rending ice, the crash of the falling fragments, and a steady undertone, like the boom of the great Yosemite fall, added to the inspiration and excitement. There was something, too, she said, in the consciousness that so few had ever gazed upon the scene before us.